So this is E698G, lecture 6. So last class, we discussed about several types of architectures for phase detectors. So we'll start this class with a very different phase detector architecture. This will be the last phase detector that we will discuss in this course. And this phase detector has very simple implementation. It has a different sort of like a weird characteristics. And it also allows us to look into some cool calculations, okay? So this is a D flip-flop based PD. The implementation is very simple. So we have a D flip-flop, D input, clock input, this is my output. I connect N1 to the D input. And I connect N2 to the clock input, and Q gives the output VPD. Okay. So now we are going to analyze this. We follow the same procedure as before. Case one, we will analyze this for phase error, which is positive, a small positive value. So we have to plot for N1. So N2, which is a delayed version of N1. And then we will have the VPD. Similarly, we will also do the plots for case 2, which is where the phase error is a small negative value. So we'll have N1. N2, which is now occurring before N1. And then we have to plot VPD. So based on our plots that we get here, we finally have to do VPD average versus phase error plot. So why don't you give this a try? Plot VPD average versus phase error for a range of -2π to +2π. Okay, let us look at the solution. So here basically my N2 is sampling the N1 signal. Therefore, the VPD output is going to go high here. It remains high and then it still remains high. Correct? So if I were to look at the average of the signal, let's say I ignore the initial transients. So I ignore the first one period and I look at the average, we'll see that the VPD average is simply equal to the high value, which in this case is VDD, but let me represent it as V high. Okay. Now in the second case, again, N2 is sampling the N1 signals. So which means my VPD is going to remain at 0. Therefore, the VPD average will be equal to 0. To generalize, I'm going to represent using VL. Okay. So now if I look at the signal, you'll see that between 0 to 2π, the value is VH. Sorry, 0 to pi, the value is VH. From -π to 0, the value will be equal to VL. What happens after pi? So now you have to imagine this waveform getting pushed to this side. So after pi, this signal would occur somewhere here and it is going to sample the zero state, right? So you will again have the low value and here you will have the high value, okay? So now let us focus on this region between -π to +π. Okay. Is this curve a linear curve? It is not linear, right? It is very highly nonlinear. But what this curve is telling us is the polarity of the phase error. When the phase error is positive, we get a high value VH, which is VDD if I consider signals from 0 to VDD. And when the phase error is negative, the value is the low value. Okay. So clearly it is not giving us some magnitude which is proportional to the magnitude of the phase error. right? So can you think of any reasons why we would even be interested in a flip, in a D flip-flop based PD? Looks like this is inferior to the other phase detectors we discussed, right? So why would we even be interested in a phase detector like this? Okay. 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 So there is, it is possible to still have a lock with this sort of a PD, right?
Yes.
Yeah. So what he's saying is if I put this in a loop, we get a positive magnitude or a negative positive value or a negative value in every cycle. So if we use it correctly in the loop, we should get pushed to this node where the value on an average, the value is either positive or negative, such that on an average, the value becomes zero, right? So it is still possible to obtain a locking in this loop. Now, the reason why people are interested in this phase detector is that the output is one bit, right? So with all the push towards moving into digital implementations of different analog loops, this is very easy to integrate because the output is one bit. So you can easily have a digital logic following this. Now, another reason, of course, is that it is very, very easy to implement. It's just a D flip-flop. So these are the two reasons why this phase detector is of interest in a lot of circuit design communities. Okay, now we said that if it is locking, it's possible to lock to the zero point. Can you tell me the gain at this location? What is the gain if the PD locked to phase error equal to zero? It is infinite, right? So it looks like it is infinite, but in the presence of certain circuit non-idealities, you will see that the gain is actually not infinite. So for this, I have to talk about a non-ideality called as jitter. Okay. So let us consider a very ideal clock. Right. These are the instances at which its rising edges are expected to occur. So these are the ideal positions where we want these rising edges to occur. But in the presence of, let's say, noise in the circuit, it's possible for these edges to vary around its ideal position. So for example, let's say the first edge occurs earlier than what we expect. The second edge occurs a little later. Third edge also, let's say, occurs a little later, etc. So the variation of these edges from its ideal position is what we call as jitter, okay? So now let's say the first edge shifted by TJ1, second edge by TJ2, third edge by TJ3, etc. Individually, these values can either be positive or negative. Now, if the original time period was equal to T0, right? In the presence of these noise components, in the presence of these jitter quantities, now my new time period is going to be different from one cycle to the next. For example, the new time period for this first cycle will be equal to, can you tell me the value? So this will be equal to TJ2 minus TJ1, where individually these quantities could have positive or negative magnitudes. All right. So now the problem is these quantities, TJ2, TJ1, these jitter quantities are non-deterministic values, meaning it is not possible to predict them. And why is that the case? It's because these arise due to random events happening within the circuit. And by random events, I mean thermal noise, flicker noise, etc. So there is a lot of randomness associated with the events that cause these jitter. Therefore, the jitter themselves is a random event and it is not possible to predict the exact value. Therefore, now we have to talk in terms of the statistics or the probability of jitter being a particular value. Okay, so let us consider a clean edge. Now, there is some probability with which the edge can shift around this clean edge, right? And if I look at the probability distribution of this jitter, that is Tj, we'll see that it has a Gaussian curve. And this will have an associated mean, which is equal to zero, meaning that we expect the edge to, on an average, occur at its ideal position. And this will have an associated sigma with it. Okay, so we expect the probability of the edge occurring at its ideal position to be maximum, which is why you have the maximum value around mu equal to zero. And this probability will reduce as we move away from its ideal position. Okay, so now if I have a Gaussian curve with very small sigma, this means that I have a relatively clean clock with the probability of finding an edge away from the ideal position to be very small. The opposite case is when I have a Gaussian curve with a very large sigma. So this is now a very jittery signal wherein this edge is going to vary around its ideal position by a large value. Okay. So now if I were to look at this output, right? So I have in one. And I have in two. Let's say my in two is delayed from in one by a quantity delta t. Let's also assume that there is some jitter associated with the edges of in two. And let's say this is represented by the variable tg. So now if I look at VPD, the VPD will have the high value under what conditions? Earlier, Tj is less than delta t, or in other words, it is delta t plus Tj is a positive number. Is this clear? Similarly, VPD will have a low value if delta t plus Tj is less than zero. Okay. So now when I calculate the average of VPD, the average of VPD will be equal to the high value into probability of VPD being equal to the high value plus the low value into probability of VPD becoming equal to the low value. Is this okay? Okay. So now what is the probability of VPD equal to high value? This is same as probability of delta t plus tj being greater than zero. Similarly, this quantity is simply the probability of delta t plus tj being less than zero. Okay. Now I'm going to do some manipulations. This I can write as probability of tj being greater than minus delta t plus vl into probability of Tj being less than minus delta t, right? Now, we would like to work with plus delta t as the expression, as the variable in the expression. And so we will do some manipulations based on the Gaussian curve. So let's say this is my jitter value and I look at its probability. So I will have minus delta t. And symmetrically, I will have plus delta t here. This is a symmetric curve. So when I say Tj is greater than minus delta t, I'm basically looking at the area that is highlighted here. Okay. Now this area is also same as, so this is minus delta t plus delta t. The highlighted area is actually same as this area here. No, sorry, not here, till here. Okay, so instead of saying probability of Tj greater than minus delta t, I can say probability of Tj less than plus delta t. So let me write that. So this is equal to VH into probability of Tj less than plus delta t. This plus VL into So here, probability of Tj less than minus delta t. Now that corresponds to this area. Area under the curve where Tj is less than minus delta t. Now this is same as the area highlighted here. Okay. So this is probability of Tj greater than plus delta t. Now I'm going to substitute Vh is equal to plus Vdd and VL as I'm going to substitute it as minus Vdd. But if you substitute it as zeros, then your expression will change slightly, but you will get a similar expression at the end. Okay. So this becomes Vdd into probability of Tj less than delta t plus minus Vdd into. So can I rewrite this in terms of this? So this will be 1 minus probability of Tj less than delta t. So this will give us Vdd into. Twice of probability of Tj less than delta t. Minus 1. Okay. So we did some manipulations. We have got an equation. The next step should be to do some sanity checks to make sure this equation looks okay. Right. So let's get some sanity checks done on this. So let's assume that Tj is equal to 0, which means we have a very, very clean signal, no jitter. Then if delta t is greater than 0, based on this equation, can you tell me what is the value of VPD? VPD average. So this is the expression for VPD average. So Tj is 0, right? This quantity is 0. Delta t is greater than 0, which means this probability is always 1. So this is 2 minus 1 into VDD. That gives us VDD. Now, if delta t is less than 0, what is the VPD average? It's VDD. Minus VDD. Okay, let's check this. So again, Tj is 0 and this is a negative value, which means this probability will always be 0. So it's simply minus 1 into VDD, that gives you minus VDD. So now if I look at the plot, so we said that this is for small values of, so in writing this, we have actually made the assumption that the delta t is smaller than t naught by 2. Otherwise, we would get very different results, right? So I can plot this for regions from pi to minus pi. And you will see that the value looks like this. The curve will look like it is going from minus VDD to plus VDD. So this is phase error and this is VPD average. Okay. So does this make sense? So in the absence of the jitter, we have got the ideal curve that we obtained earlier, right? So which means that this equation sort of passes our sanity checks. Okay. So now let me look at this expression again. So it turns out you can simplify this as VDD into error function of delta t. Delta t by sigma root 2. Okay. Now, if you are comfortable working with these probabilities, you can do that as well. But the moment you write it like this, it becomes easier to plug into tools like MATLAB. Okay. And now if you plot this, you will see that. So now instead of phase error, I'm plotting directly in terms of delta t because the expression is in terms of delta t. So you'll see that the curve is actually linear around delta t equal to 0. So you'll get a waveform like this. And so this is plus VDD. This is equal to minus VDD. And when you deal with error function, this error function generally saturates to the value at 2 sigma and minus 2 sigma. Okay. So you now have a linear waveform between minus 2 sigma to plus 2 sigma. So what this tells you is if you have a very, very jittery signal, if the sigma of the jitter is very large, then your linear region is also large. Okay. So any questions on this? This one? Right. So all that matters is if this PD is seeing the delay between N1 and N2 to be greater than 0, it is going to give VH. If the delay between N1 and N2 is less than 0, this is going to give a value of VL. Okay. So now we have to figure out when we will get the delay between N1 and N2 to be greater than 0. Right. So let's say this is my N1. And we said that the delay between N1 and N2 was equal to some delta t. But now this N2 is very jittery. Now, because of this jitter, it's possible that the edge could happen here. Right. So the delay then seen by the PD would be delta t plus the jitter value, where this jitter value can be positive or negative. So the total delay seen by the PD is now delta t plus tj. So now we have to check whether this delta t plus tj is positive or negative. So if delta t plus tj is positive, then the output is VH. If it is negative, then the output is VL. Is that clear? Any other questions? Okay. So with this, we come to the end of discussion on phase detectors. So let me give you a question as a homework. So if I have a PFD, with N1, N2, and up and down as the output, we know that its characteristic is going to look like this. So this is VPD average versus phase error. Yeah. So if I look at the output value, it is positive when phase error is positive, and it is negative when phase error is negative. Now, if I use a D flip-flop based PD, so we saw that it has a curve like this, and then it is going to switch again. So this happens at pi. Then after the value of 2 pi, this is again going to switch. Okay. So if I limit myself between minus pi to plus pi, then I can use this value, the value to determine whether the phase error is positive or negative. But beyond that, this concept is not valid. Okay. Let's say I want to have a characteristic as shown here. So my VPD average versus phase error. I want it to be a positive value when the phase error is positive. I want it to be a negative value when the phase error is negative. Okay. And I want a single bit output. So now the question is this, can you think of a way to combine PFD and a D flip-flop based PD such that I get a new phase detector with the following characteristics? So design a new PD with the above characteristics. Using PFD and D flip-flop based PD. Is the question clear? Okay, so you can do this as homework. But now let's come back to our delay lock loop circuit again. So we have some input signal. Let me call that as the reference clock. Now this goes through a variable delay line, which we called as voltage control delay line. Then we take the output of this variable delay line and then compare it using a PFD. So I'm going to use PFD as the phase detector from now on. So PFD will give two outputs. We have the up signal, we have the down signal. Both these outputs are going to the next block. What did we call the next block as? Charge pump. And the charge pump will then now will push or pull charges onto a capacitor such that a control voltage VC is developed across it. And this is then given to the VCDL. Now in this whole circuit, we know what a capacitor is. We have seen a VCDL, we have seen a PFD. So the only unknown component here is the charge pump. So let us look at what it has to do. So it basically has two inputs, up and down, and then it has an output node where a capacitor is connected. So now I'm going to give you a little extra information. Let's say when the up is active, that is when the up is high, we want this VC voltage to go up. Similarly, when the down is active, we want the VC voltage to go down. Okay. How can we accomplish this? Connected to an op amp. Okay. Can you think of something even simpler? So what if I had a current that is connected to the capacitor whenever up is high, right? Similarly, I could have another current source that is pulling the current from the capacitor when the up is low. CMOS inverter, but I want it to be more controlled. I want this current to be completely known because as you will see, that will determine the loop dynamics. So let me give you the circuit, but the basic idea is clear, right? So I will connect this up to a switch and then I will have some current source I not here. So whenever up is high, I naught will get pushed into the capacitor. Similarly, I will have another current in the following format with the same value I naught. So now whenever down is high, we are going to pull the current out of this capacitor. So let me call the current flowing through the capacitor as IC. Okay. So now tell me what happens when both up and down are high. So the I naught simply flows from VDD to ground and we won't have any current flowing through the capacitor, right? So this is the whole delay lock loop circuit. Okay. So now we have to analyze this. So we will analyze it step by step. What we'll do is we will first look at only this portion of the circuit. Okay. And we will see how it behaves when we give a constant time delay between the two inputs. So let me redraw that. So we have the PFD. I'm going to call this as in1 and in2. So I have a current I naught. So this is up. This is down. This is also I naught. And it is connected to a capacitor C. The voltage on this capacitor is VC. Current flowing through this capacitor is IC. You can assume that VC is initially zero. That is the initial condition. Okay. So now what I want you to do is, let me give you an N1 and N2 waveform. Let's say N1, N2, and there is some delay between the two. So you have to plot up, down, the current through the capacitor IC, and finally the voltage across the capacitor VC. Please give it a try. So up will go high when N1 goes high. Down is going high when N2 goes high. And after both up and down have gone high, both the signals will come down after a duration of T reset. Okay. So let me sketch it out here also. All right. So now what happens to the current through the capacitor? This remains at zero when both of them are off. Okay. When up goes high, you will have a current I0 flowing through the capacitor. What happens when both go high? This becomes zero. And then you will have the same thing here. So what is the width of this current pulse now? That will be same as the gap between N1 and N2. So if this is delta T, this is also equal to delta T. So now let me sketch out VC. So it starts at zero. And when you have a current flowing through this, it's going to increase linearly. Right? So what is the increment now? How much is the value? So I0 into delta T is the total charge that has now been pushed into the capacitor. So this divided by C will give you the magnitude by which VC is increasing. What happens after this? It remains a constant at this new value. Then it will again increase. Then it remains a constant. Then corresponding to the next edge, which is here, it will again increase, etc., etc. So can you comment on the steady state value of VC? Let's say I wait long enough, to what value will VC settle to? You're saying VDD, assuming VDD is the limit, right? But theoretically it is infinity. If VDD could have gone to infinity, this will eventually go to infinity. So what we have now is basically some block. We have given a non-zero phase error. So this is also a constant value. So a non-zero constant phase error. And we are getting the output as infinity. So what comments can you make about the gain of the system? Infinity. Okay. So let me rephrase it a little bit more. So when I say constant phase error, I can think of this as a DC phase error. Is that term clear? For example, if I had a DC voltage, all that it means is that if I plot it across time, let's say I have a voltage V0, this is represented in volts, it is a constant, right? Similarly, now I have, with respect to time, a phase error, this is a constant. So when I give a DC phase error, I get infinity at the output. So what operation should be here such that you get infinity as the output when you give a DC value? Integrator. So you basically need to have some sort of integral operation. Okay. Now let's say if we are able to bring this out from in this PFD plus charge pump plus capacitor cascade. Okay. So earlier we talked about the average voltage present at the PFD output. Right? But now you can see that this averaging is happening in terms of the current, because when up is high, you have this current getting pushed out. When down is high, the current is getting pulled out. So the averaging is happening in terms of this current. Okay. So can you tell me what is the expression for the average current through the capacitor? Let's say I have a delay between in1 and in2 as some delta t. So over one period, what is the average current? Right. So this will be equal to I naught into delta t divided by t naught. So this is equal to I naught into, what can I replace delta t by t naught with? This is equal to phi error by 2 pi. Therefore, now my VC voltage is simply 1 by C integral of the average current with respect to dt. So if I want to find out the VC voltage at some time t naught, I have to integrate from 0 to t naught, right? So this will be equal to 1 by C integral from 0 to t naught. I can take out all the constants outside. So this is I naught by 2 pi into phase error and integration with respect to dt. So clearly, as your time of observation t naught increases, your VC value will also increase. It is going to ramp up. And that is what we have seen based on our waveforms also, right? And when can you get a proper steady state value for VC? From this expression, is there any combination which can give you a steady state value for VC? What happens is if phase error is equal to zero, then you get some steady state value, right? So this will give you a steady state when phase error is equal to zero, okay? Or in other words, if the input seen by the integrator is zero, then you get a steady state out. Okay. Okay, good. So now let's put the whole thing in feedback and see how this behavior is going to affect the negative feedback action. Right. So let me copy this. Now I have a reference signal. And this is going through a VCDL whose delay is now controlled by this control node voltage. And I have closed the loop. Let me call this as the out signal. Okay. Now let's say I have implemented this VCDL using current start inverters. Okay, which means I can expect to see a curve like this. So y-axis is the propagation delay and x-axis is the control node voltage VC. And let's say the time period of this reference, T ref, is occurring somewhere here. And corresponding to this, there is that magic value of VC, which I'll simply call as VC naught now. Okay. Now, let's say we start with capacitor having zero voltage. That means we start from this point. Okay. So let me plot reference. Now, reference is input to the loop. It doesn't get affected by the loop parameters. So I can as well plot multiple reference cycles. Now, how should I plot the out signal? Can you tell me based on this plot, based on this curve? Don't worry about feedback. We are starting the circuit right now, right? So at t equal to zero, I have just started the circuit and I have given a reference signal here. right? I'm just interested in the out signal currently. We'll come to the feedback after that. Sorry? It is delayed by TP. Okay, TP is basically the variable on the y-axis. No, it is some variable on the y-axis, that's it. And I'm starting from here. So what should be my initial delay? So I'm basically asking you where I should put the first edge of out. Should it be here? If I draw like this, is it correct? It is delayed version. So is this correct? Okay, but this waveform is correct. Okay, so let's look at it. So I'm starting here, right? TREF is below that, which means my out signal has to be delayed by more than one TREF. So the first edge has to happen after one period. So I'll draw only the first edge now. Is this clear? Simply because I've chosen my starting point as this, my first edge has to happen after one time period, right? And the delta t that we are interested in is now this. Let me call this as delta t1, okay? So can you tell me how the up and down will behave? So the up will go high here, and it will remain high till the down signal goes high, and the down signal will go high here, right? And then both of them will fall after a delay of T reset. So the current waveform is going to go high throughout. So this is my I naught, okay? Now corresponding to this, my VC is going to increase. Okay, so now in this plot, we started with VC equal to zero, but now my VC has increased, right? Which means my delay has also come down. So we are now at a slightly smaller delay than what we started with. So the next edge is going to appear here, and we will measure another delta t here, delta t2, and this delta t2 will be smaller than delta t1. Is this clear? Okay, so let's continue drawing the up and the down signals. So the up will go high here, down is going high here, and both of them will fall after a small delay. The current I naught, IC, will go high here. And correspondingly, my VC is also going to go high here. So now in the curve, I'm again moving in this direction, and my delay will reduce. So if I look at the next period, this edge would have come even closer. So now we will have a delta T3, where this delta T3 is smaller than delta T2. So as this proceeds, progresses like this, you will see that eventually the duration for which IC is on is going to keep reducing. Correspondingly, the jumps in the VC will reduce, and eventually it will just become a stable value. And this steady state value is obtained when you finally reach this VC naught, which is the magic value that will give a delay of TREF. So this is how the delay lock loop is going to lock. And this is a slightly important point. So maybe you can take a minute and ask me if you have any questions. Sorry? What if it crosses the point of VC naught? So If it has crossed the point of VC naught, let's say because it jumped by a larger quantity here, then the PFD is going to recognize a negative phase error, which means the down will go high before the up, right? So we are going to pull out the current from the capacitors, which means the VC will now come down. Okay. At that time, delta T will be negative. Yeah. There will always be a T reset in the. So T reset is actually necessary because there is some finite time that the current sources will take to actually completely turn off, right? So in the absence of T reset, you will see that this path will stop responding correctly. But in the ideal, when I write the ideal expressions, you see that the T reset is actually not affecting our output. Because both up and down are on, yeah. So we'll come to why T reset is relevant and all a little later in the class.
If not getting started, then we will see the
value. Then you will see a constant, yeah. Mm-hmm. You can see, so if the T reset is not getting subtracted, which means if a constant current will flow, through this, right? Even if they were exactly aligned, a constant current will flow in between. I don't think wiggling is what will happen. I think it will lock with an offset. Because finally, the current flowing through the integrator has to be zero. Current flowing through this capacitor, net current in every period through the capacitor has to be zero. So if there is a T reset every period, the phases here will adjust for this T reset such that the net current is zero. So it will result in a constant offset while locking. Is that clear? We'll come to this offset part also today. Hopefully we can finish that. Okay, so now if this is clear, then I want to confuse you a little bit. So I'm going to talk about certain locking non-idealities. This is an analog circuit. Nothing is ever ideal. So let's look at some of the non-idealities that can happen in this locking process. Okay. So there are three major locking non-idealities. So before I move on to this, I want to make sure that this part of locking is clear. Okay. Right. So then there are three major locking non-idealities. The first one is called as false locking, sometimes also referred to as stuck locking. The second one is called as harmonic locking. And the third one is locking with static phase offset. So this is in short called as SPO. So we are going to discuss all three. Now, out of this, the first two actually sort of depend on the initial conditions of the delay line, like from what point we start with. So this choosing a TP, which was greater than TREF right now, was very intentional because this is a configuration that doesn't lead to any problems. Now we'll see how if I had chosen a different value, it could have potentially led to some problems. Okay. So let me start with false locking. Now, let's say the same waveform. For the same circuit, I had started with a delay which was lesser than TREF. That is my in-2 is occurring here. Or in other words, if I look at the VCDL characteristics, so this is TP versus VC. This will have a characteristic like this, right? And let's say the TREF was happening somewhere here. So this corresponds to some magic voltage. And let's say I started somewhere here, lesser than TREF. So can you tell me how, what would be the locking point? Please analyze this and tell me what the locking point would be. Right? So if I were to look at the up signal, up is going high here, and down will go high here, and both of them will fall after some time, which means I will have a current flowing through the capacitor as shown here, correct? And if this happens, then the VC is going to increase. So if VC is increasing, I started from here and I'm moving in this direction, right? Which means in the next cycle, the INTU will come closer and closer to this edge, right? So what is actually happening now is that I have a VCDL, right? I'm passing an edge through this and this edge is coming out, but the loop is working such that it is trying to make the same edge occur as the original edge. It is trying to get this edge to occur at the same instance as N1. But because the VCDL will have a minimum delay, it is going to simply get stuck at this minimum delay. So beyond this, the VCDL cannot reduce the delay. So there is a maximum value for VC, which let's say is VDD. So up till VDD, the loop is going to push the capacitor voltage till VDD, and then it will remain stuck there. Is this clear? So this is why it's called as stuck locking, because it is getting stuck at the end of the VCDL curve. Right? It is also called as false locking because it's actually not locked, right? It's just giving an appearance of locking. Okay, so now this value of T min is basically the minimum delay of the VCDL, and this will be a function of process voltage and temperature, correct? Because if I had taken a different corner for looking at these characteristics, I will have a curve like this. Right? So I'm simply getting stuck to a different value of minimum delay. Now, if this is happening, I need not have gone to the trouble of putting everything in a loop. I could have directly taken this delay line and simply given the voltage as the maximum voltage possible and left it an open loop. Right? I would still get the same delay. So basically, there is no negative feedback loop in action when this sort of stuck locking or false locking happens. Okay, so now let's look at how we can avoid this. So what solutions can you propose? Reset the capacitor. So you can set the initial condition of the delay line. So for example, if I were working with a curve as shown here, where the point of interest is somewhere here. So if I reset the capacitor to be at this node, VC equal to zero, that will ensure that the locking point has to be TREF. We will not get into stuck locking. Okay. Now, how can we reset the capacitor? I can simply connect a switch here and then connect the switch to reset. Okay, so this is a very simple solution to what looks like a slightly complicated problem. Now, another solution would be to make sure that the PFD doesn't respond to the first edge of N1, right? So for example, in this case, let's say due to some reason, the PFD is not able to detect the first edge of N1. If that happens, my down signal will go high first, right? So my down signal will go high here and my up signal will go high here, right? And once both of them have gone high, they'll come down like this, which means my IC is now minus I0. Right, which means the VC value is now going to decrease. So that ensures that we are moving in this direction. Okay, so we have to figure out how we can make sure that our PFD is not able to detect the first edge of N1. So let me sketch out the PFD. If VCD is? Huh, okay. So if VCD is above VC naught, so this is in one, this is in two. Let's say this is the period, right? And this is the scenario you're talking about, right? So my up signal, so PFD is not able to detect the first edge, but it can detect the second edge. So up goes high, and then the down will go high here, and then they come down together. So my IC is still a positive I naught. Therefore, my VC is going to increase. Okay, so it will come back to the correct point. So we just want to make sure that this first edge of the in-one or the reference is neglected. Okay, so this I'm going to give you as a homework. So this is in-one, this is VDD. Similarly, in-two, VDD, and then I have the reset. Okay, and we know that something needs to be done in this path. Correct? So this is a homework for you. Figure out how to change this PFD such that it doesn't detect the first edge in N1. It has to detect the second edge, but not the first. Okay? So I didn't follow the question. So let's say, okay. So what is your starting point, above TRF or after TRF? Below TRF. Okay. Yeah. It might happen that it doesn't cross TRF and go to?
In VC, it doesn't become smaller than VC.
Okay.
Still, even after VC, it is still more than VC.
It will be more than VC 0, right? We don't expect it to reach to the correct value in one cycle of detection. So in the first cycle, you got the waveform like this, right? Let me... Okay, let me do one more cycle here. Maybe that will clear things up. Right? So, of course, this doesn't reach the required value. But because the VC has now increased, if this was delta T1 and this is delta T2, we know that delta T2 will be smaller than delta T1. Right? Now, the up signal is again going to go high here. The down signal will go high here. So I naught is, we get a plus I naught, which means your VC will increase further. Okay, so VC increases further. So you are moving, the delay is reducing. So the delta T3 will be smaller. So it will come to the ideal locking point. Okay.
In the first case, when we are resetting the capture, and we are trying to make it below VC, and then missing the first line.
No. So there are two things. One is resetting the capacitor. Second method is ignoring the first edge.
Yeah. So I ignoring the first edge. We are trying to pull out charge from the capacitor. So we must ensure that the, at least that much charge is pulled out from the capacitor, that the VC that we eventually have after this plus are there is smaller than VC naught, so that the even when VC starts increasing, it will go to TRF.
So I don't think I'm following the question. No. When you are missing the, so tell me the scenario is into before this edge or after this edge?
Before this edge.
Before this edge. Okay, let me redraw.
Negative.
Right. So now we will have up, down occurring first. So down will occur here and up will occur here. Okay, so the current is negative, which means the VC is decreasing. Okay, now what is the doubt?
So VC is decreasing. So after decreasing, you have to show whether this VC is greater than this plot or greater than this plot. Suppose it is greater than this plot, then we are reaching that problem.
No, no. So let's say the we started at this node, right? So this is TREF. Now VC has decreased, which means you have moved in this direction at some value which is still smaller than TREF, right? So which means it's smaller than TREF, which means the edge will occur here. Okay. So my down is going high first and then the up will go high. So the current is still negative, my VC will continue to decrease. Is that your doubt?
Yes.
Yeah, so is it clear now? So see, this edge, this is a delayed version of this edge, right? Now, if the delay is less than TREF, this edge cannot occur beyond this. It has to be before this. So this edge has to occur after some T1, let's say, where this T1 is lesser than TREF. So this is T1, where this T1 is lesser than TREF. Is it clear? I think you all of you will have to spend some time in being steady with these waveforms, and I think it's already 6:30, so we can end the class here. So this is a homework for you: modify the PFD such that first edge of N1 is ignored. And then you can draw the waveforms for a positive phase error and negative phase error, like with different conditions on this waveform, and convince yourself that stuck locking does not happen. Okay.